Happy Easter. My name is Andrew, and I am the senior pastor here at CBC. I just want to welcome all of you here this morning, especially for our first-time guests. We're so glad that you've chosen to be a part of our celebration here at this church. We recognize that there are a lot of things that you could be doing and other places that you could be. So the fact that you're here is not lost on us. We are grateful for that. For those of you joining us with our online community, we just want to say welcome to you guys as well. Happy Easter. Let me encourage you right up front to go ahead and grab your Bibles. We are going to be in 1 Peter today. If you do not have a Bible here, but you'd like one, we have some beautiful leather-bound Bibles that we'd love to gift you, our gift to you, yours to keep. All you need to do is simply hold up your hand and one of our ushers will be happy to bring you a Bible. Go ahead and grab your Bibles and jump to the book of 1 Peter. I'll give you a minute to get there. Today, we not only get to celebrate Easter together, but we get to wrap up what has been an incredible series that we entitled Remain 17 weeks ago. A journey through the book of 1 Peter. And it has been a wild ride. God has done some amazing things. In fact, amazingly more than I could have ever imagined. And I'm super excited about what I believe that God has in store for us today through his word. In light of Easter, I was thinking about traditions. I come from a big family. I'm the oldest of six, three boys and three girls. And my wife and I have a big family. We have six children, five girls and one boy. And one of the things I love about being a part of a big family are the traditions. And so for us, we've got several things. One, we love getting together and celebrating the holidays through food. I mean, who doesn't? Who doesn't like a good, how many of you are going to do ham today? Raise your hand if you're a ham, is it a ham day? That's a lot of you. Turkey day? No? Enchilada? Anybody do enchiladas? I'll throw it out there. All right. I love getting together with family and friends over a meal. It's amazing. My family has always done that. Another thing that our family does is we get dressed up. A lot of families do that. They get dressed up for the day and they throw on matching outfits and almost always preceding the family getting dressed up is the family photos. And whether you like it or not, you're going to get it. So you might as well sit there with a smile on your face and enjoy it. It'll be over soon enough, and then it'll follow you through Facebook for years and years to come. So make sure they get your good side. Speaking of photos, I want to let you parents know that we've got dozens and dozens and dozens. I was in my office praying just before I got in here, and I opened up my window, and there's just a train of kids headed to the field right now to go on an incredible Easter egg hunt. And we're taking pictures and we are going to post them to Facebook. Just want to encourage you throughout the week to go ahead and find those pictures and click on them and tag yourself, link them just so that you have those to keep as well. Another thing that my kids in particular love about Easter, and maybe it's not just them, but most kids, is they love the candy. They love all the celebration through candy, the Cadbury eggs and things like that. Did you know that Easter also happens to be one of the grossest candies of all time in Peeps? 700 million of these God-forsaken things will be sold this week alone. The only thing worse than Peeps is guacamole. And I want to let you know, if you don't know my relationship with guacamole, it's not a good one. Friday night after what turned out to be an incredible Good Friday service here at our church, my wife Stacy and I went and we had dinner at Fernando's, my second office. And while we were there, there were several families from our church that decided to go there as well. One in particular was a former staff member of ours, Brooke Boswell. Brooke was my personal assistant until Friday night when the waitress came and set down a giant tray of guacamole in front of me and said, compliments of someone here, and I just saw Brooke going, and I just said across the restaurant, remember when you worked for the church? But Peeps, the only good thing about Peeps, and I mean this, is taking one out, sticking it smack dab in the center of your microwave, and putting it on for 3 minutes. You don't worry about your mom's microwave. You just enjoy it as it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And boom! I love Peeps. Who else likes Peeps? Anybody in here really, you really like Peeps? Oh, well, enjoy them. Better you than me. Another tradition that most of your families probably celebrated, or you know somebody's family who does, are the Easter egg hunts. I mean, kids for generations have been excited about Easter egg hunts. They go into these things with their eyes wide open. If you're a part of my family's Easter egg hunts, it's amazing because the eggs come with all sorts of things, candies and goodies. But then there's the golden eggs that have money. And you go into it, and all of a sudden, the kids who don't pay attention in school, kids who don't pay attention when you're talking to them, kids, I mean, you couldn't pay them to pay attention, all of a sudden, an Easter egg hunt, and they are just, their eyes are boom, and they are just, they are hyper-focused. They are alert. They're looking everywhere. They are anticipating with great expectation what they're going to get when they find these Easter eggs. And they're going around, and not only that, but if you're a part of a family like mine, it's not just about the Easter eggs. It's not just about the candy. It's not just about the money. It's about the competition. There's no fair play in Easter egg hunting. There's no, when you get 10, you need to stop and wait for your siblings. No. Weakest man gets left behind. Not my fault that you all took after mom and you're all 5'3". Let me get those Easter eggs. Oh, did you want one? And then there is the warmer, colder game. Oh, our kids love that. We'll hide the Easter eggs, and our kids will go around like chickens. You're like getting warmer, and they get really excited. Colder, colder, and then they get frustrated. And then you're on fire, and they're like, "Wait, where are these Easter eggs?" They get all jacked up for Easter eggs with great anticipation. They're alert. They're watching for these things. And they love it. And then like our family growing up, we'd take the Easter egg and we'd empty out the candy and the money and whatever else. And we would ask our parents to hide the eggs again. And if we were lucky, they'd put more candy in it. But my entire siblings, all six of us, but one have ADHD, never got more candy. What would happen, church? What would happen if we approached our faith with the same great anticipation and excitement as these children will with their Easter egg hunt? What would happen if we were alert and aware of our surroundings and intentionally looking out for our faith? What would you and I in our faith look like? That's exactly what God is going to share with us today through the Apostle Peter as we wrap up our Remain series and as we celebrate Easter together. If you're taking notes or if you're a mathematician, I have an equation for you. 5 + 1 + 4 equals the hope of the world. 5 + 1 + 4 equals the hope of the world. And it's a hope that you and I can experience if we choose to. It's a hope that we can look at with eyes wide open that can radically and fundamentally change not only our lives, but our faith. If you've been a seasoned believer here this morning, you can walk out of here this morning prepared and ready for a radical transformation of your faith. That's a guarantee. And if you're here this morning because your mother-in-law drug your butt here, good for her and welcome to church. If you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, and this is just another family tradition, today could fundamentally change the way you live your life if you encounter Jesus. So with your Bibles open to 1 Peter chapter 5, let's finish out our Remain series. And as we finish out our Remain series, what does that mean for next week? Well, I'm glad you asked. We are kicking off a brand new series here at this church called Live It Up. And I just want to warn you in advance, if you are of the opinion or the mindset that church is meant to be boring, you're going to want to skip the next 5 weeks. It's going to be amazing. I personally don't believe we're called to bore anybody into the kingdom of God. And so we are going to spend the next several weeks together having fun. We're going to have fun in worship. We're going to have fun with the messages. We're going to have fun with each other. It's going to be awesome. You don't want to miss it. You don't want to miss the opportunity to invite somebody else to come and be a part of it. Please make it a priority to come starting next week as we kick off our brand new Live It Up series. You ready, church? Hey, let's get after it this morning. Father, I pray that you would come, that you would fill this place. We invite you to live and move and have your being here among us. Ready us now to encounter you through your word. And I pray that the words of my mouth and that the meditations of our hearts would be holy and pleasing in your sight, God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Five directives that Peter is about to give the believers. And I want to recap briefly because there are several new people here this morning. For the last 17 weeks now, we've been in this series through the book of 1 Peter where the Apostle Peter is writing a letter to the church that has been in Rome but is now spread out through five different regions because of incredible persecution. And by incredible, I mean under the reign of Nero, it was dubbed the reign of terror. The kind of persecution that you and I as believers would have experienced during this time period is that we would have lost our homes, we would have lost our possessions, we would have lost our jobs, many would have lost their lives. Nero was running poles through Christians and was using their bodies to illuminate the streets as lanterns and to light his parties, his extravagant parties. Nero was the most narcissistic, cruel, and vicious leader that the world had known up until that point. He burnt Rome down. And for 3 days, anytime the city of Rome would start to die off and smolder, he ordered it relit, and then he blamed it on the Christians. He burnt it down so that he could build it up to more closely resemble what he thought of himself and what he looked like. Christians in great fear, new believers, new followers of the way. We've had over 2,000 years to come to understand Scripture. We've had over 2,000 years to come to understand the Bible and to grow in our faith. This was brand new on the scene. This idea that we could understand a right relationship with Jesus and go to God on our own instead of through religion, but through this relationship. So they're being forced out of everything that they know. They've lost loved ones, they've lost lives, they've lost all of it. And as they are spread out across these five regions, they don't speak the language, they don't look the part, they don't worship the same way, they don't worship the same God. Everything that they've known about their lives that has been stable has been swept away. And so they are forced now in this great persecution to struggle with their faith and to struggle with life. And Peter writes this letter as a form of encouragement. He writes this letter as someone who himself has been persecuted, who is being persecuted. This is preceding his martyrdom, where he would be hung upside down because he didn't feel worthy to be hung or die in the same manner of his Savior. This letter is written as a form of instruction. And today, what the theme of this letter has been throughout is that we are foreign aliens, temporary residents, just here for a short season, that this is not our home. Up until this point, we have been told countless times to stay alert and watch for the second coming of Christ, for the things to come, to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus and to not get focused on the things of this world. And now we're going to see that he moves away from not only are we called to watch out for Jesus' second coming, but he's going to give us five directives, five things that we are called to be really intentional about with regards to what we are called to watch out for in our faith from the enemy. 1 Peter chapter 5, beginning in verse 8, it reads, "Stay alert. Watch out." Two directives right out of the gate. He says, stay alert, watch out. I want to share with you briefly that at one time in my life, I consider myself to be a golfer. And by golfer, I mean I would pay a horrible amount of money to get really mad. And I just figured there's other things I could do with my money and other ways that I could get mad. So I gave away my golf clubs. But there was a season where we lived in Arizona. My wife, Stacy, and I lived in Arizona, Glendale, Arizona, for 2 years, where I was a youth pastor. And if you were good enough to golf after 1 o'clock, you could pay $18 and you could golf unlimited holes. Well, the reason is because anybody with money or a mind golfed at 7 a.m. to about 11 or 12. Then they had a changeover in staff. I didn't have money or a mind, so I went golfing at 1 o'clock. That's what you do. And I was from Oregon, so I didn't mind the 120 degree, it's a dry heat. It feels like you're dying. I don't care how dry. Yeah, dry heat. Let me crawl inside my oven. Oh, it's a dry heat. Feels great. Oh, it's still 120 degrees. It was better than 226 days of rain, I can assure you of that. But I would go golfing, and one of the things I learned early on as I was golfing with my buddy Lance is that if a ball went into the rough, you either left it there or you had to stay alert. And I didn't pay much attention. I just didn't understand it. So we're golfing, walking around until one day on the 9th tee box, we come up on this thing and there's a snake sipping a margarita in the sun. And I am so scared I can't even scream. I'm like, And my buddy Lance says, hey, give me your golf club. I said, I'll give you my golf club. He says, give me your golf club. And he goes over to the tee box where the snake is at and he smacks the tail. And this thing goes off. It's a giant snake. It had to be 17 feet long. And I said, Lance, what are you doing, man? And he said, well, that's a king snake. We don't want to kill them. They actually help get rid of the rattlesnakes. They keep the rattlesnakes away. But the only way to really tell is if you hit their tail, because they look just like a rattlesnake. I said, the only kind of snake that I care to see is a dead one. I have no desire to go smacking the tail of a rattlesnake to see if it is a rattlesnake. He said, a boy or a girl? Here's your sign. I said, what are you doing? It's a snake. But I do know that if you do go into the rough to find your golf ball, which is where most of mine could be found, you would take your golf club and you would lift the brush and you would hit the things around. Tell me, you were listening for a rattle. You were super aware of your surroundings. You were alert as to what was going on because of the dangers, because of what lied in the wait, readying to attack you. Church, we are called in the same way, not only to look forward to and watch out for with great anticipation the second coming of Christ, but while we're here occupying this earth, we are called to stay alert and watch out for the evils of this world. We don't get to just walk through this world naive, Mary Poppins with our umbrella, thinking life is just great. And the enemy, oh no, I know Jesus, the enemy's done with me. No. He's about to work overtime. And we're going to learn that here in just a second. Some of you are impressed that I can skip. I'll be honest, I didn't know I could until I did. Stay alert, number one directive. Watch out, number two directive. Watch out for what? For your great enemy. Great not being good, but great being powerful. The devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. What I know to be true of lions is that within their jaw, they have 1,500 pounds per square inch of power when they bite into what it is they're looking for. And they prowl around. They will pace back and forth looking for not a herd, not the strongest, not the fastest, but they look around and they're looking for animals that are injured. They are looking for animals that are weaker or lesser than. They are looking for animals that are isolated, not with the herd, but by themselves. And they are looking for animals that are distracted. And this is the word picture that God gives us with regards to the enemy of our lives. The Bible says further now that the enemy comes like a thief. He comes like a thief in the night to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So in order for us to know what to watch out for, this roaring lion that is looking for Christians, that are looking for individuals who are feeling isolated, like I'm the only one in this world that is going through what I'm going through. Nobody understands me. I can't relate to anyone. I'm on my own. And so then we deal with the temptations of this world by ourselves. Or dealing with Christians who are spiritually malnourished. They're sick because they don't grow in their faith. They're not actively involved in a church. They're not actively involved in the Word of God. They're not involved in a community of brothers or sisters in accountability. So they're weak in their faith. They're sickly. Or looking for Christians who are distracted, who aren't paying attention because they have other things that their attentions are focused on. The enemy comes like a lion ready to pounce on us. Church, what we are called to in our faith, for those of you who are believers and profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, is to go into your faith with eyes wide open, looking for with great anticipation, like a kid on Easter morning, for the second coming of Jesus Christ, but also to be aware of the enemy that comes to destroy you. You need to, like my friend Lance, grab your spiritual golf club, lift up the branches, and look around and be aware of your surroundings. We have no excuse to be naive. We have got to be intentional in our faith and take responsibility for our faith. And he says, here is the third directive, verse 9. Stand firm against him. And the fourth directive, be strong in your faith. When I was a kid growing up, and even now a lot of times as an adult, have I mentioned that I like competition? I do. And I love camp. I love sports camp. I loved church camp. And one of the things I loved was competition day. All kinds of competition. It doesn't matter what it is. It could be underwater basket weaving and you're going down. Like, that is my goal. I'm going to weave this basket so much faster than you would even know what to do with. But one of the things that always settled it, that always settled the score, was a tug of war. You dig out a mud pit, you fill it full of all kinds of gross, disgusting things like milk and Oreos and yellow mustard and guacamole and other things. And then, opposite ends of one another, you line up the competitors, whether you're from the red team or the blue team or the green team or the yellow team. And inevitably, I was always the anchor man. And I was cool with it for two reasons. One, the anchor man is always considered the strongest. But beyond that, I was cool with it because if we lost, I wasn't going into the guacamole. I was staying back. And so what we would do is we would get all pumped up and we'd put our gloves on or we'd get our hands in the dirt and we'd have this big old war cry that we'd come up with. And then there at the end, I would stand firm and I would stay strong. I'd ready my feet. I'd dig in and I would take this rope and I would wrap it around my waist and I would wrap it around my wrist and I'd lock in my arm. And with my other arm, I'd wrap my other arm around and I would lock in tight like this and I was ready to go. And then my job was to shout out from the back and to encourage and to stay strong. And together we would pull. Together we would work toward a common goal. And we would drive quick feet, just like football. You'd drive your feet backwards and you'd go. And always, at least how I remember it, we won. This is a brilliant word picture for how you and I are called to approach our faith. We are called. We don't just come into a right relationship with Jesus and experience daisies and roses. I mean, that's a part of it. But the Bible tells us that we are called to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Not fear that we aren't saved, but fear as in what an awesome God that we serve. We are called then to take our faith seriously. We are called to be strong. We are called to stand firm. We are called to stay alert. We are called to watch out. These are four directives. And then he gives us a fifth directive, which is remember. He says, remember that your family of believers, would you please, if you have the ability, circle that line, family of believers, all over the world is going through the same kind of suffering you are. God wants us to know that we are not alone in this. This isn't unique, in fact, to this verse, but in Ecclesiastes, we are told that one person will fall, two are easily broken, but a strand of three is not easily broken. We are called to stand together. And what God does through what he just shared with us right there, church, is he reminds you and me that regardless of our circumstances, regardless of what we're going through, we are not alone. That is why the Connections ministry at our church is so vital and so important to the life of our church. The Connections ministry that Shannon and that Jeannie and that Richard talked about exists for three reasons. It exists to connect people to God. It exists to connect people to one another. And it exists to connect people to this church. We are not alone. One of the biggest tools that the enemy has that he will use against us is making us feel isolated, like we've got nobody. Like we're in this war by ourselves, like we're going through this world alone. But what the Word of God says is you are called to remember. You are called to build an Ebenezer. You are called to erect a monument that you can look back on and understand that you're not in this fight alone, but you've got a family of believers. You may have lost your loved ones. They may have passed on, or you may not be in a healthy relationship with them. They may not want anything to do with you because of past hurts and hangups. You may have been divorced. There may be all kinds of circumstances that you didn't even wish upon yourself that you are smack dab in the middle of that, according to the standards of this world, seemingly make you alone. But I tell you that in God's economy and in God's geography, you are not alone. You are surrounded by a graced host of witnesses and other believers who are standing firm with you, like that tug of war, that have got the anchor for you. And we're going to take turns anchoring for you. We're going to pray with you, and we're going to love you, and we're going to support you, and we're going to bring you meals, and we're going to do life and ministry with you. At least that's what we are committed to here at this church. We will not go this alone. We were not created to do this life by ourselves. You are not, so long as I am the pastor of this church, you are not alone. And that is an incredible reminder. That is the fifth directive that we have, is to remember that you're not alone. And what is that it means, what does it mean for us? Well, two things. One, it means, and I've said it a couple weeks ago, but I want to say it again. God allows us to go through what we've gone through so that we can help others get through what they're going through. Lean in. Let me say it again. God allows us to go through what we've gone through in order that we can help others get through what they're going to go through. The second piece that is so important here is that it helps establish a testimony. We get to exchange lives and share stories. There's not an introverted body or bone in my body. Like, it does not exist. So it's not going to shock you to hear that I love doing life and ministry with others. My wife will go out of town and take my kids, and I'll say, when are you coming home? And she's like, well, you're fine. You got plenty of things to do. You just sit in silence and pray, or whatever you do. And she's gone 2 minutes, and I got the radio blasting, the TV on, every window open, and I'm out looking for neighbors. All right. I wasn't called to do this alone. Some introverts think you were, but you weren't. We're called to do this together. Five directives. Five plus one. The plus one is the gift. Check this out. Verse 10. In his kindness, God called you. It doesn't say in his obligation, God called you. God's word doesn't say in his pity, he called you. And the Bible doesn't say that in his guilt, he called you. Or out of obligation, he called you. The Bible says that this gift that he gives you is a gift of kindness. The only time that you give a gift, generally speaking, at least me, is a gift that I choose to give, that I want to give, that's done with intentional thought, with intentional effort. And if you were here a couple of weeks ago, you know that I never give a gift on time. I always give it early. I have no patience. I can't wait. But it's done because I love that person and I want to demonstrate with kindness that gift. And that is, the gift that God gives us is done with kindness. And it says that God called you to share in his eternal glory. I want to talk theologically for a moment about this idea that he called you. This is a term that is known as prevenient grace. Now listen, I believe that we are creatures of free will. We see that from the beginning with Adam and Eve in the fall in the garden. We see that throughout Scripture. We are creatures of free will so that God is not able to superimpose his love on us and force us to love him. That's not a love relationship. A love relationship is one that is entered into mutually and worked on collectively. We are called in free will to accept the gift that God has for us, which is a right relationship with Jesus, which changes everything. We'll talk about that here in just a second. But I also believe that God calls us. And this term, prevenient grace, when it says that God called you, it means that long before you and I recognize that God is at work in our lives, he's stirring up in us. He's doing something. He's working through circumstances. He's working through people. He's working through what you hear, what you see. God is at work in your spirit, and he's drawing you by the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. I don't think any one of you is here by mistake this morning. I don't think that you accidentally turned on County Road 75 and came out here and like, well, I was headed toward Omaha, but we're here. Might as well go see what's going on over there. There's a police officer directing traffic. Well, it must be good. That did not happen. Like, you come out to the country on purpose. And I believe that even before that, God was preparing you for this moment through his prevenient grace, grace that would be given before you even knew he was at work. Through his kindness, God called you to share, to become a co-heir, to an inheritance as a child of God's in his eternal glory. I love this because Peter again reminds us what he said from the beginning, that this world is not our home. It is here today, gone tomorrow, like a mist, like a vapor, just gone. That we are only foreign aliens and residents and temporary residents here. That this is not our home, but we have an eternal glory that we get to look forward to by means of the gift. And that gift is Jesus Christ. So now you have five directives, one gift. And that gift is why we're here this morning. Without that gift, this is little more than a social gathering. But with the gift of God, through his son Jesus Christ, who over 2,000 years ago vacated a tomb. And I want to explain this to you for just a moment. Mary, after Jesus' death, was not able, amongst the believers, to properly bury Jesus because of the timeline, because of the time frame. You see, religious law, it was coming upon the Sabbath, and when Jesus died, it had fell over into the Sabbath, and you are not allowed to work on the Sabbath. You are not allowed to travel even more than a certain distance or pick up a certain number of things or do. You couldn't, according to religious law, do several things on the Sabbath. That was reserved for God, a day of rest. So for an entire day, they are left to their own trying to figure out what was going on. What did all this life with Jesus mean? The miracles that we saw, the signs that we saw, the wonders that we saw, the teachings of Jesus, the prophecies fulfilled, the prophecies foretold. What did all this amount to in this moment? They're left there broken and lost because everything that they had given their lives to had seemingly vacated with Jesus' death. When he breathed his last and said those seven final words, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And in that moment, Jesus gone from this earth. But the day comes, and Mary, before daylight, runs to the temple that was built into the side of a cave in somewhat of kind of a valley or a cistern. And what would happen is there would have been a team of individuals that would have taken this rock and they would have had rolled it down the side of this hill in front of this tomb. And the only way to get it open would have been with a team of people that would have moved it up or moved it out of the way to get into the tomb. The problem with that is that the tomb was guarded with Roman officers, those under Nero's reign. They were standing watch, and when Mary got there, the guards had no idea how it had happened, but this tomb stone was rolled away, and the tomb was empty, and she lost it. There she has an encounter with Jesus, and in one word, in one name, Jesus says, "Mary, what are you looking for?" And she falls down before Jesus. She can hardly believe it herself, and they have an encounter. And here is something amazing to me. Through generations and generations of amazing Bible teachers and preachers, Jesus himself gives Mary a directive, and he says, "You go and preach the gospel. You go and tell my brothers what you have seen, what you have witnessed." The first person to ever preach the gospel message of Jesus Christ was not a famous evangelist. It wasn't Billy Graham. It wasn't Luis Palau. It wasn't R.C. Sproul. It wasn't C.S. Lewis. The first person to ever preach the gospel was a humble woman. She went back obediently and she shared with her brothers in Christ. "He's gone!" And they say, "What do you mean he's gone? He's not there! The tomb is moved away," and they came and ran and they see that he's gone. But as they leave, then Jesus has this encounter. She goes back a second time and she says, "This is what I encountered with Jesus." And it fundamentally changes everything. And for the next 40 days, Jesus continues to do life and ministry with them. Because Jesus conquered death, you and I get to live. Because Jesus conquered death, we get this gift that God is talking about here. He says, "In his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Jesus Christ, by way of Jesus Christ, by what he did in his life, death, resurrection, ascension." And we wait with great anticipation and eyes wide open that second coming. And then what I love is for everybody who receives this gift, there's four promises that follow. I told you that the hope of the world is 5 + 1 + 4. Well, here's the four. 5 directives. Stay alert. Watch out. Be strong. 1 gift, Jesus Christ. Now, followed by 4 promises. These are promises that fundamentally change everything we know about ourselves and about how we live our lives. These are promises that when you enter into a right relationship with Jesus are yours. We're going to talk about that here in a moment. Here are the 4 promises. So after, the second part of verse 10, so after you have suffered a little while, he's talking now to these individuals who are caught up in their circumstances. These are the 4 promises that God will give you through Jesus Christ. Number 1, he will restore you. He will restore what has been lost in this world. He will restore your health. He will restore your relationships. He will restore your finances. He will restore that lost time. It may not look like you and I think it should look, but the Bible promises that when we know Jesus Christ and when we enter into a right relationship with him, we will experience restoration. That's the first promise. The second promise for every believer who shares in the kindness of God and his eternal glory by means of Jesus Christ is that he will support us. Jesus, on more than one occasion, is referenced as saying that his yoke was easy and his burden was light. It's a word picture for farmers of oxen or like livestock that would have a yoke placed around their neck. What happens is that if you have opposing livestock, you have a bull and you have a goat or a donkey, the bull would do all the work and all the pulling, and it would pull to the right or to the left and would lead the way. And so you had to have support. You had to have like livestock doing the same work, the same objective. And Jesus says, "Take my yoke upon you, and I will support you." He says, I will pull with you. I will stand with you. I will support you. That is a promise that we as every believer in here gets. And we need to understand that we're not alone. And not only do we have the support of one another, but we have the guarantee that through Jesus Christ, we will find our support. The third promise for every believer who is called by God's goodness and kindness and will receive eternal glory by Jesus is that he will strengthen you. And Jesus knows a thing or two about being strengthened, because if you were here Friday night, or if you've read the story of Jesus in Gethsemane, leading up to his arrest, trial, persecution, and death, he cries out, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. And as he's grieved, and as he's broken, and as he's weak in his body, the Bible says that he was empowered and strengthened by an angel of the Lord. He was strengthened by God. The hope that I have here is that I don't have to be good enough, because God is enough. I don't have to have it all figured out. I don't have to go through all the calisthenics and the cardio and the exercises and try to figure out through works how to be good enough, because God is enough. If you would bow your heart and bend your knee to Jesus Christ in soul surrender, and I mean soul in two ways, S-O-U-L as in your entire being, and S-O-L-E as in all that you have. He is enough, and he will strengthen you, not in this moment and only in this moment, but for the rest of your life. That's a promise. How does that say? You can take that to the bank. And the fourth promise for every believer is that he, being God, will place you on a firm foundation. You have to understand, I want to take you back to the minds of these men and women who are hearing this for the first time. What is their foundation? Their foundation has been stripped away from them. Their foundation is rocky at best. Their foundation likely feels like they're sinking in quicksand. And that every time they move, they sink a little deeper and a little deeper. Their foundation had been ripped away from them. Everything that they had built their life on was gone. Imagine, common vernacular and in today's language, you go home to find out that your house and all of your belongings, along with every family member you have been burnt to the ground. And not by accident, but because of your faith. Your foundation is rocked at the core. It's gone. Most of us conceptually will never understand that, and I praise God for that. But it doesn't mean that that's not what was going on here. These individuals had lost everything. So the promise of a firm foundation, it meant the world to them. We have the benefit of living in the 21st century in the greatest country in the world. Are there things going on that could always be better in our country? You bet. Just turn on CNN or Fox News or any affiliate and you recognize that it's not great right now. But it's better than anywhere else I could imagine. And so we've become comfortable with the foundation that we've built, with the house that we've built, with the life that we've built, with the money that we earned to build it, with the relationships that we've created to build it upon. This is our foundation and we're comfortable with it. But this is all temporal. And when that foundation is rocked, and if you have not had your foundation rocked right now, it's because you either just had it rocked or there's a possibility that it's going to be rocked in some capacity. But here's the hope that every believer has this morning. When you walk into a right relationship with Jesus, eyes wide open, he will take you out of the things of this world and build you on a firm foundation. He'll set you on a firm foundation. He'll take you from the cheap imitations of this world, the things that you've been investing in as a foundation. drugs, the foundation of alcohol, broken relationships. You go ahead and fill in the blank. But he'll move you from the weak, faulty foundations of this world. And the promise that we have is that he'll put us on a firm foundation with the expectation of eternal glory. And Peter finishes, all power to him forever, amen. That word amen literally means in total agreement. It means I say it again, amen. This is not by our own power, or our own doing, but by the power of God and him alone. This is reserved for the hand of God moving. And I just want to encourage you, let me talk to you for a moment, you who are believers in Jesus Christ, you who are here this morning and you have surrendered your life to Jesus and you wave the banner of Christ and you claim Christianity. Let me talk to you for just a moment. I don't want you to leave right now in just a moment as we wrap up and sing and exit those doors the same way you came in. And what I mean by that is, I believe that through the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit and his word, he can change the composition of our hearts. And here's what I want to remind you, that as fully surrendered followers of Jesus, we have a task, we have a responsibility, not just to go through life, but to go through life intentionally, on purpose, with a purpose, and for his purpose. And we are called to watch out, to stay alert. It means that we are called to watch out with great anticipation for Jesus' return, where he calls us among to himself, and we experience eternal glory with him as we stand before the throne room of God, singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was, who is, and who forever shall be. And we are no longer in pain. We are no longer in sorrow. There is no more weeping. There is no more gnashing of teeth. We are fully restored, made complete and whole and perfect before the throne room of God. We are called as believers to anticipate that with intentionality, to look forward to that day. We need to stay alert. And on the other side of that coin, we are called to stay alert for the schemes of the enemy, who comes to steal, who comes to kill, who comes to destroy. Don't let the enemy have a foothold. Don't give the enemy ground. Stand firm. Be strong. Be committed. Remember that you're not in this alone. You got a body of believers. Walk out of here today encouraged and intentional. Like those little kids that are out there doing the Easter egg hunts. They're looking around everywhere looking for Jesus. When was the last time you looked for Jesus at every turn? Where are you, God? Thank you, Lord. And you're looking for Jesus. You just can't wait to encounter Jesus. You're looking for him in your relationships. You're looking for Jesus at your work. You're looking for Jesus at church. You're looking for Jesus at every opportunity. You're even looking at obstacles as opportunity to see Jesus move. That's what we're called to, with great anticipation. And then, like my stupid friend Lance, grab that golf club and start lifting up the bushes and smacking the ground, and know that the enemy, the more you turn to Jesus, the more he's coming after you. So be intentional in your faith. Don't leave here the same. Leave here changed. Now I'm going to talk to the rest of you for a moment who don't know Jesus as Lord. Man, what an incredible monologue between Emily and Justin. Religion versus a right relationship with Jesus. If you're here this morning and you've been going through religious motions, but you've never fully surrendered your life to Jesus, then today is just another holiday. Today is just another family meal for you. Today is just another photo opportunity. Today is just another Easter egg hunt, another excuse to start your diet over again tomorrow. But if you would say this morning, Pastor, I want to bow my heart and bend my knee to the Lord of all creation. And I recognize that what I've been doing hasn't worked. God, through his prevenient grace, has been calling me, and I've been fighting it, and I've been running from it, and I've been ignoring it, or I didn't even recognize it, but now I do. I can't claim ignorance anymore, Pastor. I know that there's got to be more, and I want that more. Then this morning, you can know that sure salvation of a firm foundation by simply bowing your heart and saying, God, I believe in you. I'm sorry for my sin. Forgive me. And make me new in you, and help me to live the life that you talk about through that crazy pastor who has two volumes off and wow. Either way, don't leave here this morning without making a decision. If you know Jesus, decide. Today is a day of reckoning. I will no longer walk through this world naive and just going through the motions. I'm going to do it on purpose, with a purpose, and for His purpose. Or decide that today is a day of reckoning where I give my life to Jesus. With every eye closed, with every head bowed, let me pray with you. Father, I thank you so much for this morning. I thank you for I thank you for what you did over 2,000 years ago that conquered death so that we could live. Hallelujah. Thank you. Father, for those of us who are hearing this morning, and we've been struggling, we've been doing it on our own, and we've just kind of been going through the motions. Thank you that this morning you give us five clear directives. You remind us of the one gift and the four promises that follow. Help us to live in that salvation and in those promises to live on purpose. And for the individuals here this morning that are hearing this message, maybe for the first time ever, maybe for the first time like this, well, you're drawing them unto yourself right now, Lord. I pray that you would forgive our sins. That you would come into our lives. We invite you in to come and to do as you will. Have your way with me. Father, I recognize that the things that I've tried, they haven't worked, and I've been doing it on my own, but no more. I want to know you. I want to live for you. I want to love you. And I want to know today that you are God and that I can experience eternity because of you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. If you made a decision this morning and you said, today is the day I gave my life to Jesus, I want to hear about that. I want to know about that. And not because I'm good at record keeping, I'm horrible with numbers. But because the Bible is clear that when one enters into a right relationship with Jesus, there's a party in their honor in heaven. So I want to celebrate with you. I'm probably going to hug you. And two, I want to help you. Because today was the decision, but it's just the beginning. It only gets better from here. I want to help you. I want to help you get equipped. I want to get you plugged into the church. I want to get you plugged into relationships. I want to get you growing in your faith. Starting next week, there's that class that I mentioned. And whether you're brand new in your faith or you've been stagnant, you need to be there. Come at 9:15 and go to the class at 11, or go to the class at 9:15 and come to church at 11. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be awesome. So excited. Did I mention that next week we're starting a brand new series? It's going to be so awesome. I don't want you to miss it. It gives me great privilege to say to you this morning, because of what Jesus did, happy Easter. I love you guys. Have a great day.